Let me introduce you very shortly our first keynote speaker, Professor Dieter Kraus, from the City University of Applied Sciences, Bremen, and Institute of Water Acoustics, Sonar Engineering and Signal Theory, Bremen, Germany. Dieter Kraus received a bachelor degree from the University of Applied Sciences, Bielefeld, Germany, in 1983, and master degree and PhD degree from Ruhr University, Bochum, Germany, in 1987 and 1993 respectively, all in electrical engineering. In 1987, he attended the NATO Settlement Undersea Research Center La Spezia, Italy, as summer research assistant. From 1987 to 1992, he was a research associate at the Institute of Signal Theory at the Ruhr University, Bochum, in Germany, and a visiting research associate at Polytechnical University Madrid, then Polytechnical University Grenoble, and Technical University Lisbon. From 1993 to 2001, he was with Naval Systems Division at Atlas Elektronik Bremen, where he was finally head of the Department of Future Mine Hunting Sonar Concepts and Theoretical Investigations. He is now professor for Technical Acoustics and Signal and System Theory at the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science, City University of Applied Sciences, Bremen, Germany. His main research interests lie in the area of underwater acoustics and sonar signal processing, particularly in the design of acoustic transmitters and receivers arrays, modeling of sound propagation in an inhomogeneous ocean environment, data acquisition and signal conditioning techniques, advanced sonar signal and image processing approaches. This keynote lecture has a title, as you can see, and please.
Thank you very much. Welcome to the audience. I would like to speak about regression techniques today, and the regression techniques are becoming in the current time more and more popular because we have additional requirements, particularly in the signal processing area. One is interested in sparse representation of signals, and therefore the regression could serve as one particular tool to get those sparse representation. And therefore I would like to give an introduction today into this area. It's only a first step, and of course I would like also to motivate this by a certain number of applications. So I will show you via the applications why the regression is quite important or can be important. Then I of course will introduce the linear regression model. If we have defined a model, we need of course a cost function. The cost function we want to consider are either the maximum likelihood approach or the least squares regression, or later on we have the regularized versions of those least squares regression. Since those techniques often have some shortfalls, we of course consider then possibilities to overcome those problems, and one technique is maybe to make a piecewise regression. The other thing is maybe to have a sliding piecewise regression, and this can be of course formulated in a certain sense that we have a particular filtering approach that makes then the calculation quite fast. To motivate then the regularized least squares regression, I have an intermediate step that is then the maximum a posteriori estimation, because that motivates how the regularization comes into the least squares regression. The least squares regression are in that society known as shrinkage methods, and those shrinkage methods of course are either, I will propose at least here, is the rich regression and the lasso algorithm. They have then certain properties, they are of quite interest, and I will at the end summarize all those things and give also a short outlook. And my first example I have for an application of a regression problem is maybe quite attractive in so far that we have in Germany with the Volkswagen a problem with the exhaustive gas. And in so far, the Bosch company was, but it was before, interested in making some measurements. In that case, the European norm 6, that is of course coming soon, requires quite strong limitations for the carbon monoxide, the carbon dioxide, and for the oxide of nitrogen. Of course, to measure those things is quite expensive because those sensors are expensive, and to get this additional data is also then maybe not attractive, at least for a serious product. Therefore, we know that we already, for the motor management, for the engine management, we have 9 measurements. Those measurements are, of course, indicated.
The first button
without any sound. Of course, we have all those measurements. We have here 9 measurements. The torque, maybe the rotation speed, additional things like inject fuel quantities. I don't mention all those, but those measurements are within such a diesel engine already measured and are, of course, combined here and used for the engine management. Also, we are measuring some temperature within our already existing catalyst system. But now, of course, the goal is we are measuring already those data. The sensors are there. If it is not possible to predict from this 9 measurements, now this 3 additional measurements, so that we can avoid to install actually 3 additional sensors. And so far, we developed then 2 models. One is here we have our input data. X of D, that it consists of 9 different elements. Then we want to, of course, predict the value Y of D, that are the 3 parameters you actually want to estimate. And the black box in between the system should be now determined. And one can imagine that not only the current sample we have at that time, also a certain history should be present. And therefore we have here a certain tape delay line, so that we have also certain history values. In our investigations, we figured out that a number of 9 is quite suitable, so that we have at the end here 9 by 9 means 89 data inputs, and we want to get 3 data outputs for this carbon dioxide, monoxide, and this oxide of nitrogen. And of course, in between, we actually want to learn the function that maps this one in that 3 values, and therefore it is a regression problem. It could be solved by a neural network. It can be solved by an ordinary regression, or the best we have then figured out was the Gaussian process regression approach, that is at the end something that is what I described at the end. The model can be, of course, be even a bit more complex by making it as a feed backward procedure, so that we have not only a history of the input data, also we store a history of the output data, and therefore the input vector becomes even longer. But at the end, the calculation, and therefore this model, has to be taken into account because it provides a better result. Another application we have in mind is more related to my main issue, that is the sonar imaging story. We have, of course, here on the left side, just a snippet, a small region of interest of a sonar image. The sonar image here taken by a SAS system, so that you get a kind of idea of the resolution. The resolution is nothing else than 2.5 by 2.5 centimeters. So that means the resolution is quite high. But we want to, of course, see on the seafloor particular targets. These particular targets we are interested in because I have a certain relationship to the defense industry, is we would like to detect mines lying on the seafloor and want to, of course, distinguish them from rocks. They are, of course, not of interest. Therefore, the goal is to have a image segmentation, and the output of our image segmentation is given here at the output. We want actually to get this intensity pixel image in a 3-color image that gives us maybe 1 color, in this case a red one, for the highlight domain where the target is. That is a cylinder-shaped target here at the moment. On the other hand, we have here behind a shadow because that is the target height prevents that the acoustic sound can penetrate to this bottom, and therefore we have there a shadow. And on the other hand, this is the backscattering from the roughness of the seafloor itself. So we want to make this classification in the three classes, and this is done here in this case by a regression tree. So the simple idea there is I would like to take a horizontal line here or a vertical, maybe we assume now for the moment a horizontal line, and I change the height of the horizontal line in such a way that the division in the upper image and the lower image is of course then considered, that I try to make the difference between the upper limit of the pixel intensities and its mean value plus the intensity values in the second part minus the mean value here, that this becomes a minimum. So I shift this line until I get this, and maybe within the whole image maybe this line is formed. Then we have two parts of the image, and the same procedure is done then for both images, both halves of the images. So for the bottom part maybe we have selected then this one here. So that means after we have done the first part, we are getting the image step here, it's the lower part of the image, and this is the upper part of the image. Then we divide the upper part again in two pieces, and then the lower part is also again divided in two pieces, and so on, by this cost function. At the end, we can make many steps, and this is maybe after n steps. The number of steps we are doing is, of course, larger than shown here, because we want to make a more very small patches so that we can cover the contour quite exactly. Nevertheless, we have now many patches, and we have in each patch one particular mean value. At the end, I don't want to have many colors, because each mean value would have a color. I want only to have three colors. So that means I have to make a processing back from the big tree. I prune it then up to shorten and cut out the leaves so that I get at the end only three colors. So that means I try to combine those different patches if they are close together in its mean value. That is done, and we obtain, of course, this result here. That is, in general, also a kind of regression, and therefore it is also called regression tree. The other example is also coming off from my area. We have also other techniques for segmentation. Here we have, again, this cylinder target with the shadow here. And in this case, we have just already applied a level set algorithm to determine the contour of this shadow. But as you see, if the bottom is somehow rough, even the contour becomes quite rapidly changing here. This is, of course, not suitable for the classification procedure, because we want to have a certain amount of features, but as less as possible. Therefore, we try to express now this contour with not by all its pixels it is describing. We want, of course, to model it by a certain shape, and there are, of course, attractive those Lamé curves. Those Lamé curves are nothing else than ellipses in a certain sense, because we introduce into the ellipse equation now an additional parameter. If epsilon is 1, then we have an ordinary ellipse. If epsilon is, of course, smaller than 1, we are getting more and more rectangular. If epsilon is, of course, larger than 1, we are coming closer and closer to the diamond. And therefore, we are now trying to get all the contour pixel values now matched to this kind of contour. And the result we obtain is this one here. It's quite a smooth result on one hand. On the other hand, we are getting immediately the parameter A and B that gives the width of the ellipse in the both dimensions. And we get, of course, an ellipse epsilon parameter that tells me something about if it is more rectangular or not. And so far, we have immediately three parameters that can be used for a classification, because this kind of shadow maybe belongs, due to its length and extent, only to maybe a cylinder in that orientation. And so far, an intermediate requirement is there, the regression. Other topic we have had is together with the Fraunhofer Institute in Bremen. They are specialists in sensors and sensor networks. They are, of course, designing those sensors, and more the signal processing is not their main business. And the goal was there. We have maybe containers, they are on a ship, and they are coming from maybe South America to Europe, and have, of course, as an example, bananas in the containers. And one would like to have the temperature profile within a container. So one needs to have many temperature sensors there, and one wants to have the temperature distribution over this container. Of course, you can imagine now that we have many sensors there on one hand. On the other hand, we have many containers on the ship. So the data amount is quite high. On the other hand, we have the sensors here. They should consume as less as possible energy. Therefore, they should not transmit all the data. We should have a data reduction. So the problem here is, on one hand, to make a regression to the individual measurements, to denoise them, to maybe remove outliers. But on the other hand, we are also faced with the problem to reduce the amount of data. We don't want to transmit each sample. And therefore, this is now my example for the next steps. I now take to express now this whole thing more mathematically in detail. Now this as my simulation example. So we can now interpret that, of course, maybe we have here the time axis, and we have here maybe the temperature axis, and we are now determining here, or we have now measured the deviation maybe from a desired temperature, so that we can consider maybe that is 1 degree more than expected. And we have, of course, now simulated this here by a well-defined function we already know, and we have introduced, of course, an additional noise, so that we simulate now those measurements, because if you want to investigate those algorithms, we have at least to know the ground truth. If we have real data at the end, we of course never know what is really the truth, and therefore we cannot compare the performance of the algorithm. And in so far, we have to introduce now our model. And our model consists now of a course of the signal part and the noise part. And the signal part here is now my linear model. But the linear model is not just that we have only a linear dependence on t, only the parameters are linear. And that means I have here a linear combination of functions h1 up to h subscript j. They are called basis functions. And those basis functions are, of course, rather arbitrary. I could take maybe wavelet functions therein to make a certain superposition to estimate the parameters. I could take also for the FFT actually those basis functions in, then the basis would be orthogonal, but I actually have any degree of freedom to put there any function in. Of course, it should be suited to the problem. If I have this situation, then I usually don't use it for any time instant t as a continuous time, I just take samples. So if I take samples now at the time instance ti, I indicate it now as a measurement as xi, accordingly the noise, and my basis functions are also now only evaluated at this particular time instances, and therefore I can denote them just by the subscripts I and j. So that for one particular measurement I can represent the whole story in this form. If I now have not only one measurement, I have measurements from 1 up to I can write this equation one row by the other from ranging from 1 up to I, and if I then observe that I can represent it in a matrix notation, I can write it in this form here. So this is my final representation for this model in a matrix notation, if I have I measurements. The H matrix has column-wise the basis functions in, and the theta are now the unknown parameters I want actually to estimate. Now, of course, we can fix those basis functions, and in my case, to make it here for this presentation simple, I take just ordinary power so that I actually use a polynomial fit. That means now, here usually is the function h1, here was the function h2, and so on. My function h1 is nothing else than a constant at the moment. h2 is a linear function t, h3 would be then t squared, and so on. Again, if I go to the equidistantly sampled data, I of course can represent it in this form here, where the ti is now nothing else than I times ts, where ts is the sampling period I have. And of course, if I would plug in now this data, it is maybe a bit inconvenient to have there maybe here ti in. It makes sense to plug in their ITS at this point and to eliminate the ts. So that means if I replace the t theta here by the handwritten theta divided by t, then I can eliminate the sampling period so that I can write it in this form. And then again, it has the same structure as before, so it allows again this representation in matrix notation. now we have the model, but we need a cost function. One cost function could be the maximum likelihood estimation, and therefore we suppose that our noise we have is normally distributed. And we have a mean vector of zero and a certain covariance matrix with a scaling factor. We assume that the covariance matrix, that means the correlation between the data, is now supposed to be known. Only the variance is unknown. If the noise has this property, then of course the data we observe have then this property. That means the same covariance structure, but due to the deterministic part here, we have this as our mean value, so that we obtain this as our distribution for the observed data. Now the maximum likelihood principle says we have to maximize the density function for x for the parameters that are unknown, that are theta and sigma square, if we plug in our observations x for the small x. If we do that, we of course obtain by maximization then the desired theta hat and the sigma hat as the estimate. And one can of course find in this simple case, because we have linear parameters, a closed form solution for the theta as well as for the sigma. So that we have this closed form solution. On the other hand, one could think we are taking, instead of the maximum likelihood, now the least squares approach. The least squares approach in general would have here an identity matrix, and then this would nothing else than taking the minimum of all the differences squared if the theta is optimized. In our case, if we have a knowledge about the covariance matrix, we can plug that in as a weighted least squares, because the weighting is in so far beneficial that it weights those differences where the variance is small, because we have the inverse here, the variance is small, then the difference should be also small. In cases where the variance is high, of course the difference can be then low. And so far, we have a proper weighting of the differences, and therefore it is outperforming, if it is known, the ordinary least squares. If we now maximize this here, we of course also obtain the theta hat, and accidentally, or not so surprisingly, it is the same as the maximum likelihood. So the least squares approach and the maximum likelihood approach with our assumptions is the same. In this case, of course, we do not estimate the sigma parameter, and I did not say that actually this estimator is a maximum likelihood estimator, but it is a biased estimator, it's not any more optimal. Therefore, one is taking here then an improved estimator that is called restricted maximum likelihood estimator. We are just scaling our former one suitably so that it becomes then an unbiased estimator. But this is not important in our case, because this is just a Noisian parameter that is not essential for us. Essential is the theta parameter. Nevertheless, the least squares technique has a certain certain drawbacks, or we have to consider, of course, also the order of our model. And therefore, one can investigate how does the least squares approach react to outliers. And if we have outliers, maybe I have here a simple simulation where the dashed line is the true line and perturbed by noise, so we are getting the dots. If we have created one outlier that is more or less in the center of this data piece, then of course the effect on our estimate is not so severe. But if we have an outlier at the edge, then of course the slope is of course differing quite significantly from the true slope, and it's getting even worse if we have here more than one outlier in the location of the edges. So that means we are faced with a problem to may somehow act against those outliers. One technique I'm not considering here is of course the Rensec algorithm. The other approach we want to address here is we are cutting our observation time in pieces and making then a piecewise regression. Another alternative is then the regularized regression. Another problem with the least squares is also the order estimation if I have a long data piece. The original data are repeated here again. If I just would take order 3, 7, 11, or 15, one can observe that actually 15 is somehow required to somehow recover this peak here, but on the other hand, I'm getting also already here some artifacts. So that means to get a balance between the order and the creation of artifacts is also then a problem, and therefore we either having an underfitting or an overfitting problem. And again, the piecewise regression might be helpful. To mention how the order could be estimated, there are of course two criteria well known. One is the archaic criterion and the other one is the Bayes criterion. They are able to determine the order of the polynomial we should take for fitting the data. Here is just a simple example of a few samples, and if you would take the data here, of course, for order one, then we are getting one cost function value here for order one. That is maybe then this one here. If we take the order two, then this fit is quite okay. We are getting this cost function value. If we, of course, take a higher order, as mentioned here, with five, then, of course, it is already increasing, because it is not only taking the deviation into account that would monotonically decrease, it is also taking into account a certain penalty that I should take order that is as small as possible. And in so far, this criterion provides reliable results and is quite useful in all those applications. Nevertheless, if we now consider the piecewise regression, then I now introduce within a certain, this here is a function that is only one as long as the time is within this interval. So that means this part here is only active if the time is within this time interval. So that means I have actually a sum here of all the pieces, but at a certain time only one element in the sum is active. And I now make, of course, a theta estimation for each of those pieces. And in the equidistant sampled case, it is nothing else than this one here. That means I replace the t accordingly by I times ts, and then I, of course, get this representation. And again, I can represent it in my classical form. The only difference is now that I have for each piece now a certain set of parameters, and therefore my parameter set is growing quite significantly. And here is now an example for just having here a sinusoid per term, so the measurements are again the dots. And if I would take now a piecewise regression of zero order, that means I approximate everything by a mean value, then I have, of course, the green lines. If I would have a first order, I would get this one here. And if I allow a third order, I have even this one. In my former experiment with the simulated data, we also have done this here for a third order, but you see, the problem we have is we are getting now here discontinuities. So just to make a piecewise regression is not a solution. We have, of course, to make here at the edges from one piece to the other, of course, a constraint that the curves are fitting together so that we have a certain continuity property satisfied. And that is, of course, then possible by just imposing to our optimization problem now a certain number of constraints in accordance with the order and the continuity requirement we have then, of course, a certain number of constraints involved. That means if we have maybe the order of one, then the number of parameters, that is the J, is two. That means we have here zero, then we have zero times continuously differentiable. That means they are just continuous. Accordingly, if I choose J larger, then I get a higher continuity property at the edges. I can now, of course, model this in a certain way that usually I have actually these constraints, but the constraints in optimization problem are always difficult to handle. One can now show if one is designing the model in a certain way, one can avoid these constraints or they are inherently incorporated. And there is now the simple idea. One has one polynomial that is ranging over the whole interval domain, that means from the beginning, not up to the end, over the whole interval. And the other ones are then starting later. And they are before zero, and then of course they are starting. Here it is general, but this drawing is a specific example where I just take a linear polynomial approach. That means I try to use here only a linear model, but I start that accordingly here also at the specific cases with a linear model. That means in this case, for instance, the first basis function is the one that is, what is the dashed line here, that is ranging over the whole time domain. Then the next one is the dashed line that is here the slope, that has the slope 1, that is the t, that is the second basis function. All the other basis functions have the slope 1, but they are always starting one piece after the other, up to the end. And if I use this as my model, I have then an advantage. I can, of course, write it here in this form in general, can, of course, take now all the corresponding data. That means I have from the beginning now theta 1 up to theta j. In my case, for the linear approximation, it's only theta 1 up to theta 2. And then I get here additional k parameters. So the number of parameters is also reduced. And if I incorporate that again in my model, I have nothing else than the first j columns are as before. Only the next one are then including this basis function. And then we obtain the following results that are our basis functions for the linear case. And after I have estimated the parameters, they are minimizing the least squares criterion, then this basis function is weighted by a factor maybe 0.8. Therefore, we are getting this dashed line. This function is by theta 2 weighted, that is a negative slope now, that's this one. All those are getting now a corresponding parameter and therefore getting a slope that is maybe positive or negative. If I then superimpose them, then I get, of course, this solid line as my estimate. And in so far, we, of course, have, due to the linear interpolation here, only the continuity, but it is now a closed form curve. I cover here the peaks quite well, and I do not cause any artifacts. And if I consider this for the sinusoidal model, you see also if I take the linear, I at least come a bit better to the sinusoid, but with the cubic polynomial, I already get a good agreement with the sinusoid. So that means a piecewise approach, in this case, with this continuity requirements, is then quite powerful. Nevertheless, we have the problem now to cut the whole data set in pieces. In accordance here, I have taken now cubical splines as a fit, and as the whole order, that means it's always order 3. But I divided now my x-axis either in 5 pieces, in 10, 20, or 40. And here again, one is observing that, of course, the choice of the number of pieces is quite relevant, and therefore 20 is, of course, suitable in this case, but one can also have here a kind of overfitting. And therefore, there is also a formula available that tells one what is the right number of pieces one should take. Here I may have now one example for the next step, because before we have always taken here one interval and have done one regression. In this case, I have now a sliding piece. And this sliding piece means I take, in this example, 25 samples, I make a regression of first order, and I only want to replace the value in the center now by a denoised, by a smoothed value. Then I shift it by one value, and then I get, of course, the next value. That can be probably shown.
That is running somehow. How that typically works.
So the sliding window is now going through those points. Always I make a certain regression, and at the center I replace the measurement value by the, of course, value obtained by the regression. Now one has, of course, the design parameter of the width of the window as well as of the order of the model. And so far the smoothing can be then, of course, even increased. It depends now on the data. I only represent here how it works, and that this is, of course, a quite attractive way to do it. But usually you could imagine that if I make maybe the first data piece, I make one optimization step to get the best parameters for that fit. Then I shift it by one and it makes the next complete calculation. So that would be cumbersome. So it would be helpful that I have a more fast calculation. And that is, of course, obtained by now introducing the Zawadzki-Golay filter. The idea, of course, is now I always make a fit to a sliding window, that is again my model here, but this here is now of course changing. If I have the data sample K, then I take a symmetric window around this data sample for the fit. If I include that in my model, I can of course make first, before I include that in my model, I make a centralization. That means if the data piece is maybe somewhere here located, I just take the center, then the time shifted to zero, so that I have always a symmetric window around zero. Therefore, my model becomes then unique for all different steps. So that means for each data I have always the same representation given here. I can plug in that again in my model. And of course, I get now for each k, that means my k indicates the center of my window, and xk is then all the data that are within that window. I get for that then, due to my least squares estimation, then an estimate for theta k. And this theta k estimate is that one we have seen before, that is nothing else than this formula here. So that means we on one hand get the formula back from the former least squares criterion, where the data here, that are the data we observe within that window. And to reconstruct now the value at time instant t, we just have to multiply it by this row vector h of t, where we can plug in here our time of interest. If you now take for this t exactly the value where we have our center, then we plug in here nothing else than k times ts. So if I plug in k times ts everywhere here, then all the elements in this vector become zero, only this one is one. And that is essential for the next step, because we can now say at the center of the window, the value can be obtained by just this simple vector with one here and our theta k. So that means this here times this vector. Now I can understand this E1 together with this complete expression as a new vector g, and I have to multiply it always by the vector xk. If I now shift the whole story by one step, then the g remains the same, only the xk has one new data and one old data is kicked out. So that we get a sliding window, and we can represent it as an ordinary FIR filter. And we're getting a sliding window approach. Therefore, it's quite easy to apply. On the other hand, if we are not only interested in the smoothing of those data, if we also want to interpolate, then we can now interpolate in the vicinity of the value k, always only plus minus ts around, because in the case where I would go beyond that, I would take the next fit. I always take one fit of the window only within the vicinity plus minus ts of the center, because the next interpolation would use, of course, a slightly different set, and therefore would vary a bit. But I could also overcome by this the discontinuity problem we have seen before. On the other hand, I can also make a kind of interpolation, because if you are interested in, you may have samples in a certain sampling rate, I could now create maybe between two samples an additional sample to make an upsampling. That is also sometimes attractive in signal processing. And so far, that is a fast possibility to do it. And an application, in my case, is for instance now the multi-beam echo sounder data. And may I have to explain a bit about how the data are collected. First of all, we have here a surface vessel, and there below we have the so-called echo sounder. The echo sounder is this device here. It has here a kind of transmitter, and has here a receiver, and on the other side is also a receiver. This transmitter is unifying with one transmission the complete area, that is usually plus minus 60 degrees. So then, of course, the sound is traveling towards the bottom and then is reflected. And within this complete transmission vector, I have, due to the receiver, the ability to form beams in parallel. I can form the beams in all these directions. And you see here, these small tiny things are, of course, the footprint of each beam. So maybe I have 120 beams stepped in 1 degree. And that means nothing else. I transmit and I receive. And then, of course, I get one strong backscatterer. That is, of course, the backscatter as I hit at the bottom. So I get in distance information. So I know the beam direction, the angle, and I know due to the travel time, the distance of this point. So I get one point that measures now the distance to the bottom from this point. And I do that for all the angles here. So I get for this measurement now actually a set of points on this line covering somehow the topology of the bottom. Then this vessel is going, of course, further forward, and therefore I make the next scan and I get the next column of those points. So at the end I get actually a point cloud that somehow models the sea bottom, the sea floor. Of course, there are some noisy measurements in. Also, of course, I have here R and phi coordinates, and my pixel grid is, of course, XY coordinates. So I need also there an interpolation from the R phi to the XY. And therefore, we could also use this sliding window technique, but extended to a two-dimensional case, to create now from the point cloud this kind of topology of the seafloor, or as shown here. So that are those applications where this is helpful. On the other hand, up to now I have only considered the maximum likelihood and the least squares criterion as a cost function. Another approach could be the maximum a posteriori estimation or regression. There is the additional requirement or assumption that we have not deterministic data. We assume that even our parameter theta obeying a certain distribution. And if we know this distribution, of course, we are not anymore maximizing this likelihood function, we are then maximizing this a posteriori density function. Of course, if we are doing that, we can also say, one can show that this cost function mentioned here will give the same result. So maximizing this density function is the same as minimizing, this part here. And we observe that this here is nothing else than the least squares criterion, but we have here somehow the kind of penalty term. And the penalty term is, of course, in accordance with the uncertainty. If the uncertainty of our data theta is quite high, then the lambda is very low, and therefore we come to the ordinary least squares criterion. If the sigma theta is very small, then our confidence a priori is quite high, then of course this parameter gets a higher impact. If we now minimize this, we of course obtain with theta tilde here now this kind of estimate. And the difference is quite small compared to the ordinary least squares. We only get this additional part here in this inverse matrix. And so far it is easy to implement at the end, and it makes a certain robustification. On the other hand, if we would not come from the maximal posteriori approach, if we would say, okay, this is actually a least squares criterion, then I can understand, okay, I have just taken here an additional penalty function that penalizes somehow the length of my vector. So I'm looking for a vector theta that minimizes the least squares criterion, but with the shortest vector length. And so far, this could be also immediately considered in the least squares regression problems, and those techniques are known as regularized least squares regression. Now, the so-called ridge regression is using exactly that what the map estimator is doing. It's just having as a penalty this constraint. That means the length of the vector squared should be smaller than a certain desired design parameter. Another approach could be that I take, of course, here this city block matrix, and in accordance with this two, we are getting now two different estimates. Nevertheless, if we introduce those penalty functions, we have to make before a certain pre-processing of our model. That means the columns we have in the H matrix should be standardized. Because you can imagine, if I would multiply one column with a factor 100, then accordingly this parameter theta at this element would be 1 over 100 smaller. And therefore, that would violate somehow my constraint. Therefore, I have to standardize, first of all the columns. And also, I make a centralization of the xi data to maybe remove already the mean value. Okay, in general, we have now the situation that the estimate we have here now has to be, well, this criterion has now to be minimized, subject to, of course, this constraint. And with this constraint, I incorporate by the Q, of course, either if Q is 2, I have immediately the ridge regression. If I use Q equal to 1, it is the lasso principle. One can reformulate this constraint optimization problem in an equivalent form known as the Lagrange form. So we are getting then exactly that what we already know from the map if Q is 2. And if we now consider those two approaches, then we get, due to the analogy to the map, the ridge regression has the same result on one hand. Therefore, we get an explicit solution. Nevertheless, the lasso is now not anymore in closed form solvable. We need there a numerical solution. And to interpret now the difference between these two techniques, I have now these two diagrams. And this diagram shows the following, that the theta hat is, of course, in the case that we have now only two parameters, that is required now to make this visual, they have only a theta 1 and a theta 2 parameter. Therefore, the vector theta that is used without any constraint is, of course, given at for this point. If we now would, of course, take a certain cost function value, then the theta value within this level set curve here will, of course, be having the same optimal value. But we are now looking for that value that also satisfies the constraint. That means here we have the circle. That means if the radius of the circle, of course, is here 4, that is in our former equation here, the requirement that the t must be in this case then 16. So that means if I would take a t equal to 16, corresponds to the circle equal to 4, that means my parameter theta should lie within this circle. So now I look for the optimal least square solution and all level set curves I can draw from that. And if this is intersecting then this point, then I could say this is the optimal solution under the constraint that t is chosen to be 16. Here it is then accordingly a stronger t and so on. The same is of course true for this side here. But there, the constraint is not anymore this circle shaped. It is here this by 45 degree rotated square. And the difference one can now observe is if my penalization is getting stronger, I always get on this trajectory to this value. At the end, of course, the penalty function will control everything, and the parameters are converging at the end to zero. But what we see is on the whole track to this one, always theta 1 and theta 2 are used to model our signal. In the other case here, we have the situation that after a certain penalty value, we can decide only theta 1 is relevant because the parameter theta 2 is already zero. So that means if we take the basis function 1 with the parameter theta 1, is now already a good representation of our signal. So that means this lasso criterion provides us with the ability to select the most essential parameters, so that we can describe the signal by as less as parameters as possible, of course, under a certain accuracy requirement. And the same can be shown under the situation that the estimated parameters are not correlated, because then we get in circle, but the consequences at the end actually the same. So we can in so far see here now that we have with the rich regression a closed form solution that is of course a benefit, but on the other hand we are not able to use this as a kind of selection of the parameters. That is the benefit of the lasso. It allows us to select the most important parameters and therefore allows us to find a sparse representation. And that is coming back to my signals with the banana problem, that I of course now can reduce the amount of data I have to transmit. And as a summary now, I can say on one hand that the least squares regression under certain conditions, that means if the problem is quite moderate, if the basis function are properly chosen, we of course can get satisfactory results. But we have problems with outliers, always under an overfitting. Therefore, the technique with the piecewise regression, of course, gives us the ability to overcome that problem, but nevertheless, we have then the problem how we should choose the pieces, how many and how they are located. And it does not provide us, partly it provides us only with a sparse representation. The sliding piecewise regression has, of course, the benefit in this FIR filter implementation. And for those applications, it is really an attractive idea. We use that in the two-dimensional case for the point cloud smoothing to get the bottom profile, but it can be also used in one-dimensional cases as well. And the regularized one, of course, providing due to this constraint a bit of robustness against outliers, but of course the closed form solution an advantage for the rich regression, is a disadvantage for the lasso because that is a programming, it takes a bit more time. But in both cases, the mean square error is smaller than typically for the ordinary least squares. The lasso has the benefit of parameter selection property, that means we can define a sparse representation, and in performance in general is superior compared to the rich regressions. And of course, one can show that the techniques I have mentioned here belong actually to the more general class, that is the kernel-based regression. And within the kernel-based regression class, there also belongs the support vector regression as one technique, as well as the Gaussian processes. And so far, it is from the optimization at the end, nothing else. It's only a way from another viewpoint. And so far, those things should be now also somehow available within that, if one has those applications at hand. Okay, thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate.
One short question about computational complexity of these approaches and especially for implementation.
Of course, they are due to this, in the case for the bottom profile reconstruction, it's just an FIR filter that's very fast. In the other cases, for the if I'm mistaken, the lasso, then one has a quadratic programming problem, and there are also many toolboxes available that makes it very fast. So this is actually not anymore a problem. And to give you an idea, maybe that fits into this image here, because this is the underwater vehicle we are using for those missions. That means this is somehow going a certain trajectory, and there is then on the side a side-looking sonar, and this side-looking sonar has to, of course, create the data, has to make the image segmentation, so those regressions are there, has to take the features out of it and the classifier, because this vehicle is maybe 12 or even 24 hours somewhere moving, and one does not want just to record the data and later on one wants to investigate them. It should be done in real time, and therefore the processing of the SAS and the image formation, all those things have to be done in real time. And the constraint there is, because it is often military-driven, not the computational load in general, but there is maybe then the energy consumption question. So because we have to be able to make all the calculations within 24 hours, and therefore the consumption is important, and therefore this is maybe the more limiting than the computation in total.
Thank you. Any other question?
Yeah.
In underwater acoustic transmission, the multipath sometimes is an issue.
Yes.
How do you think you can face, for example, also noise reduction?
Usually we have here two side scan sonars, because one can also make in addition a interferometric one. But the idea there is, because we are in Germany always in shallow water, so we have a multipath problem that is quite severe. One usually has on one hand a transmitter that has a quite low vertical, small vertical angle on one hand. On the other hand, we have a receiver where each receiver element is, of course, of three or four elements, so that we can even vertically steer our individual element. That means during the sound is transmitting, I know due to the travel time where it is now hitting the bottom. Therefore, I can each individual element within the antenna can be steered vertically in accordance with the sound propagation, so that we always have only a small beam receiving towards this bottom where we expect now the backscattering, and therefore we are very insensitive to all the other directions where the reflection is coming from the surface or from somewhere else. Okay?
Other questions? If not, then thanks again. And this one small gift from
you. Thank you.